coming to you with words and teaching that will change your life forever.
All things that you will ever need in your life, they're wrapped up in the Word. Go for the Word. You need to understand this thing. And when you get a hold of it, keep saying it. Don't stop talking it. Keep saying it. Keep saying it. The Bible says in the city of Ephesus, so mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. Can you shout amen?
I'm set on the course that I must follow.
In the name of Jesus, prosperity is mine. In the name of Jesus, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul.
Yay! Pastor Chris, word hearing.
See, we're living in a day where you are either a victor or you are a victim. You're either a victor or a victim. And the Bible shows us that we can actually decide. We can actually decide whether to be victors or to be victims. We can actually decide whether to be victors or to be victims. Victims of circumstances, victims of the economy, victims of the social structure of our cities and nations, victims of the politics of the day, the governments of the day, victims or victors in life. We can actually decide. Now, you have to come to the understanding that God is no longer trying to help the Christian out of a predicament. You've got to get this right. See, we haven't gotten the message. Most of God's children don't understand the Bible, because most of them read the Bible with the background as the chief influence of their lives rather than the Holy Ghost. For example, if you've suffered so bad and then God brought you out of trouble and now you're born again with all the, you know, maybe you're called of God, you see God as the one who brings people out of trouble. And so if you're not careful, all your life long, that's the message you're going to preach. And you share with Christians how he'll bring you out of trouble. So you see God as the one who brings people out of trouble. See? We've come to that point in our lives where we must flow with the Holy Ghost or sink with our past. It's about time God's children came out of their past. Tell somebody, it's about time you came out of your past. It's about time you left your past behind. Now let me tell you what I mean. We are looking to God, the great God, who will help us out. God is going to make a way where there is no way. God is going to change things. God is going to lift you up. God is going to bless you. God is going to. We have lost the vision of what he's already done. And there's no big wonder. It's mostly in the church for one reason. There's a slave mentality in the minds of many of God's children, including many of the preachers. And I'm not being critical, just making an observation. There's a slave mentality. We are still preaching a God that will bring you out of Egypt and take you to the promised land. What's the preaching of God who leads you out of your wilderness? And so we can tell a lot of God's children that they are still in the wilderness of life. But the problems they are having today is because they are in the wilderness. Tell somebody, it's time to wake up. It's time to wake up and know where you really are. Hallelujah. See, we're thinking God wants to wash us clean and do this thing and do the other thing. God wants to. I told you the other day, God doesn't want to prosper you. He's not planning to prosper you. He's already done it. He's not trying to make you rich. He already did it. It's too late to decide whether you want to be rich or not, because he already made you rich. See, but we haven't seen that. We're trying to take steps towards prosperity. No, we're supposed to be acting as people who have been made to prosper. God has caused you to prosper. He is not going to make you prosper. And you know, during the finance convention we had, that was the idea that the Holy Ghost was bringing to your spirit. That's the reason you found yourself doing the things you were doing. Giving offerings like you never did all your life. Making releases like a man who was prosperous. You found yourself, you gained dominion over everything in this world. Nothing was too big for you to make a release of, because you found out that the greater one had already possessed your spirit. Hallelujah. But there is this slave mentality that a lot of God's children have. They're looking forward. They're looking to the Almighty God coming into the situation. But you are the saved of Jesus Christ. The saved. Not the one who is going to be saved, but the saved. We haven't seen that yet. We haven't seen the real picture. See, what God's children need is not how to know the ability of God. They already know God's a great God. The very definition of God is enough to tell you who he is. Are you still there? God's children don't need to know that God can bring them out. They've heard that all their life. What you need now is what is in your hand. What can you do? Not what God can do. Everybody knows what God can do. And that's the reason, after they're inspired and then there's a shouting and there's a rejoicing in the meetings, they go back and the problems remain. Because they have not found themselves in a practical situation where they apply the word of God and put the situation right. They have not found out that God calls them the saviors. They are looking for a savior. He saved you and made you a savior. Oh, come on here. Are you still here? He saved you and made you a savior. But a lot of God's children don't know this. They are still inspired and excited to know God can do it. And that he's going to bring you out, and he doesn't bring them out. So that's one reason a lot of them can't even tell people what they're going through. They have to hide it. They have to hide what they're going through. The ball is in your court. You are the one to do something about it. And that's why you can come to the house of God and learn it. Learn the word of God. Go back and apply it to the real situation that you are facing. Hallelujah. Are you still here? He says, saviors shall come from Mount Zion. What do you think he's talking about? That's you, saviors. He calls you saviors. He calls you saviors. What did Jesus say? He said, when you enter into a city, he said, Heal the sick that are therein. You know, I was telling you the other day, when you study the Bible, Jesus never asked us to pray for the sick. Always he said, heal the sick. He never said to pray for the sick. He never said that. He never said that. When you study the life of the Master, when you study the words of Jesus, and study his prayer life, and study everything he said, and the instructions he gave, he never made us. He never made us one moment to cry for anything. He said, speak to the mountain. He said, if you shall say to this mountain, say to this mountain, say to this mountain. See, he's putting the keys right in your hands. He said, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they shall drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. He didn't say, when they shall drink any deadly thing and then it hurts them, they cry unto me and I will save them. But that's what we preach. I don't mean here. I mean a lot of people, God's children, a lot of them are preaching that. If you drink any deadly thing and it hurts you, cry unto God and he'll heal you. And Jesus didn't say that. He said, if they shall drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Hey, hallelujah. There's a difference. Come on. I said, there's a difference. But we take it, and then it hurts, and then we cry. But Jesus said, it shall not. If you were to see the face of the Master every time you cried out and said, oh God, because of what I ate, that's the reason my tummy is turning. If you were to see his face, you would never say that again. I just said that to say this. A lot of times you think when you pray and then you are mousing like a mouse and praying like a pig and with your head down in the mud. You understand what I'm talking about? And while you're doing that, you think God is being sympathetic as well as he's looking at you and feeling sorry for you. And then the Lord, all right, you prayed so hard and there's so much tears coming out of you. I better do something now before you die. No, sometimes he's angry at those words coming out of your mouth. How would you like to see your five-year-old son or daughter licking food on the ground with the tongue? And then you say, get up. And hallelujah. Well, that's what we're doing. That's exactly what we're doing. Read the words. What does he mean by greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world? What does that mean to you? Maybe it doesn't mean anything. The greater one lives in you. He's not outside. And we are waiting for God Almighty to come down and do something and change the situation. My God will do it. My God, and God is saying, go and do it. See, he's not afraid to give you the credit. He tells you to do it. Find out if you have the means, if you have the ability to do it. What's all that Holy Ghost you have inside you? Ye shall receive. That's what Jesus said. Ye shall receive. Come on here. Ye shall receive. Ye shall receive. Book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Ye shall receive. Ye shall receive. Ye shall receive. Not I have. Ye shall receive power. Power. Greek dunamis. Meaning the dynamic ability to cause changes. He said, you shall receive that power to live inside you. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be proof producers. That's what he said. But we haven't seen that yet. And so we're still crying, oh God, oh God, oh God, our help in ages past. Our hope for years to come. Be thou our guide while troubles last. That's not a New Testament song. It's not one of the songs of Zion. I said it's not one of the songs of Zion. Did you hear me? It's not one of the songs of Zion. He said, ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And ye shall be proof producers. Proof producers. Proving the kingdom of God. Proving the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Proving the kingdom of God. That's why he said, when you go, he says, into whatever city ye enter, he says, heal the sick that are therein. And then preach, saying, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. He said, heal the sick that are therein, and tell them, here is the kingdom. See, we are not just preaching about the kingdom of God far away in heaven. No, we carry the kingdom of God. We are the representatives of the kingdom of God. We are his ambassadors, legal representatives, chosen legal representatives. We are authorized. Do you understand that? Backed with power, divine power. Maybe for some it sounds too good to be true. But until your Christian life comes into this level, you are living below your call. For sure. Living below your call. Get to understand what Jesus meant. If you shall drink any deadly thing, you. If you drink any deadly thing. Some of you, you have to run to the toilet 10 times a day because something is happening to you. If you shall drink any deadly thing. This one is not even deadly. Even a deadly one. He's telling you it will have no power. This is not deadly yet. And it's messing you up in the toilet. I mean, you just can't go to work. You have to sit down close to the toilet or something. Because every 10 minutes you got to visit it. But Jesus said, if you shall drink any deadly thing, he didn't say when you pray about it. He said, these are the signs. He didn't say you will perform those signs. He says, these are the signs. These are the indications that you have come. He's telling the people how they're going to know you. Oh, you didn't get that. You want to see it again in the Bible? It's in Mark's Gospel, 16th chapter. See, a lot of times people have read it wrong. They don't understand this. They've read it wrong. St. Mark's Gospel. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to your name forever. I want to read from the 14th verse of the 16th chapter of St. Mark's Gospel. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Hey, hallelujah. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Tell everybody things have changed. That's the good news. Listen, it's not good news when you say things are going to change. That's still hope. Everybody's hoping that things are going to change. But things have changed is good news. Go into all the world and tell everybody things have changed. Tell them things have changed.
Oh, yeah.
He that believeth.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs, thank you, Lord Jesus, these signs shall follow them that believe.
I want you to observe this. Watch this, watch this, watch this now.
These signs shall follow them that believe. Now, did he say, these signs I shall perform? He said, these signs shall follow them that believe. You know what he's doing? He says, now,
anybody who believes shall be saved, and anybody who doesn't believe shall be damned. Now, so how are you going to know those who believe? Now he says, this is how you're going to know them. Watch out for these signs. When you begin to see these signs, you know they are believers in Jesus. These signs shall follow them. He says, in my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Hello. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Now, watch verse 19 down, because this is where some people get confused. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Look at that. That's where they miss it. They say, the Lord was the one confirming with signs following. So when they went to preach, the signs that followed them was the Lord confirming. So they pray, oh God, confirm our word with signs following. No, these are two different things. Don't you understand this? The Bible says the Lord working with them. He's performing his signs, and they have their own signs following. Oh. The signs following that the Lord was performing are not these casting out of devils and healing the sick. No. Okay. Hello? Okay. 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 If they shall drink any deadly thing, will the Lord be giving them deadly things to drink to prove that he's with them? Huh? You know what he's telling them? He's saying, those who believe in me are supernatural beings. That's the reason when they drink any deadly thing, it has no power over them. That's what Jesus is saying. These are supernatural beings. They are supernatural beings. Now, when you come into this realm of the supernatural, because you see, you are born into it. You do not grow into it. You are born into it. It is your life. You didn't grow into humanity. You were born into this. Come on. Were you becoming more human every day as you were growing up? Did they say you were becoming more human every day? That little child, 1 year old or 2 or 3 days old, is as human as a 90-year-old man. He doesn't get more human. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. See, you are supernatural. He says, if they shall drink any deadly thing, it's not a promise. They said, oh God, you promised that these signs shall fall. It's not a promise. Look at this. If I were to describe for you how to get to church, and I gave you 3 or 4 signs to know how close you are, would that be a promise? Would that be a promise? If I told you that you there'll be a red gate when you get there. There's you'd find a red gate. There's a white fence. All right? Would that be a promise? I'm just showing you how to know. It means they're already there. That's what Jesus was saying. He wasn't making a promise. He was telling you what is in you. He says, in my name shall they cast out devils. He's telling you that in his name, when you speak, demons must have to leave. They have to leave. He says, when you discover that those devils leave because those guys cried out the name of Jesus, he says, no, they are believers in Jesus. These are those who have received eternal life. We harass the devils when we come in. We harass them. Do you understand? When we walk in, they are scared. They shake, they tremble. You have to know this because this is the truth. Jesus says, in my name shall they cast out devils. We don't have to war with them. When we come in, they are in trouble. Mm.
Oh. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God. So, in our lives, we have to come to that level where we understand what Jesus brought to us. We say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. That's the word of God. He says, he of God. Come on. First epistle of St. John. No, we've made songs out of them. We sing them, but we hardly act them. But this is our life. Can you say amen? Amen. Say, this is my life. Say, the word of God is my life. I am doing the word of God. I am practicing the word of God. I am living the word of God. This is my life. This is my picture. Yep. As you go through the New Testament, the epistles, they are the album of the church. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right, let's look at this now. First epistle of St. John, the fourth chapter. And I want to read to you the fourth verse. Those first four words are so powerful, so powerful, so anointed, so powerful. Listen, ye are of God. Listen, that's enough to have church with. Just to read that and understand it, you can go home celebrating. He says, ye are of God, little children. You know what he's saying? When he says, ye are of God, he doesn't mean that you are on God's side. I want you, the language here is very important. He is not telling you that God is for you. He is not telling you you belong to God. When he says, ye are of God, he's talking about your origin. He's saying, little children, remember, a dog gives birth to a dog. A cow gives birth to a cow. Ye are of God. In other words, you are the offspring of God. You have come from God. You hail from God. Your origin is from God. That means ye are God's. Too big for religious Christianity. St. John chapter 10. You know, when people don't like to accept that, we got to give it to them like this. The boogie to shake up. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Ah! Ooh, ooh. Hey, 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 hey. Aye, yeah, yeah, it's right there, glory to God, chapter 10 and from verse 33, the Jews answered him. See, the Jews were standing before Jesus, and they encountered Jesus here, and Jesus, the Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makest thyself God. Listen, they picked up stones. And as they were about to cast them at Jesus, Jesus says, hold on, I've done a lot of things. A lot of good works. For which of them do you stone me? They said, for good works we do not stone you. But we stone you because you, being a man, you, a man, you're making yourself equal to God. That's why we want to kill you. Watch this. Hear Jesus. I love Jesus. It's good to know the word of God. Let me tell you. You see, the devil, he can talk. He can make his big mouth anytime. One day, I was about to take my breakfast. And I had my Bible. I had been going to the Bible studying. As the table was being set and I moved my Bible away, I heard the voice of the devil. He said, look at you. He said, you're taking the word of God away for food. That's what the devil said. He said, you're taking the word of God away for food. Physical food. Say, you're taking the word of God away. As I moved the Bible away. I said, get out. See, he'll accuse you with anything. Anything. He'll accuse you anything. I've been studying the word. And he says, I just moved the Bible so I could set the food right. He says, you're taking the word of God away for food. Isn't that just like the devil? Hallelujah. He accuses you with just anything. Now, let's go to verse 34. It's good to know the word of God. Now, when you know it, you can pin him down all the time. Keep him where he belongs, right under your feet. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Verse 34. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, I said ye are gods? He's quoting the scriptures. He said, isn't it in the law? God said, I said ye are gods. Hey, look at it. Come on. Hey, it's there. Is it not written in your law? I said ye are gods. If he called them gods, he called them gods. Hello. If he called them gods unto whom the word of God came. Hey, and the scripture cannot be broken. Say ye of him whom the Father had sanctified and sent into the world that blasphemous because I said I am the Son of God. If I do not the works of my Father, believe me not. Whew. How many of you have seen our videotape outpouring of the Spirit? If you don't have one, get a copy quick. It's changing lives all over the world. All over the world. It's changing lives. If he called them gods. Hey, let's see where that came from. Hallelujah. The word of God is so important. Book of Psalms. Psalm 82. If he called them gods. He said, isn't it written in your law? Jesus is quoting the scripture. Let's go to that place and quote it. Ah, no, 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 no. Tell me, when you read this now, you understand why someone can be going through a lot of problems, family problems, business problems, financial problems, and he'll be crying, and then his life will look like he doesn't know God. People wonder, why are you going through all this? The day those things will stop is the day you say, enough is enough. Then when you say, enough is enough, you know what the Father will do? He'll be clapping for you. Come on, son. Come on, let the devil have it. Come on. When you have nothing that anybody can see, and you say, I possess all things in the name of Jesus. When you start talking like that, when you start acting that way. You know, you ask some people, did you give an offering? Well, I didn't. Why? I didn't have anything now. If God gave me something, now I've given it. You just lied. You just lied. But you have a shed on you. What are you waiting for? You have your shoes on. Did you say you have nothing? You came with a bag. Did you say you have nothing? You have your bangles on. Did you say you have nothing? You have a wristwatch on. Did you say you have nothing? Never have nothing for God. Be tough for him. You cannot have nothing. You are not a nothing. You're somebody special. He says, do not come before me empty. Are you hearing this? That's the life of God. That's the life of a man or woman that's prosperous. He never lives like a nothing. Are you still with me? Psalm 82. I want to read from verse 5. Oh, from verse 1 will be all right. Let's just take the whole chapter so you get it. God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. Oh. Hey, 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 hey. Hey, hey, hey. Aye. He says, God standeth in the congregation of who? The mighty. He judgeth among the gods. He is in the congregation of the mighty. Who? Look at the mighty here. hallelujah. In the Old Testament, he said to them, one of you shall chase 1,000. Two of you shall put 10,000 to flight. What would three do? That's the Old Testament. Without the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I told you, see, this is one reason for talking in tongues. He said, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue emboldens himself. Isn't that what we saw? If you ever feel timid in your life, if you ever feel like running away, if you ever feel like you're nobody, and this thing coming out against you is so tough, begin talking in tongues. Don't talk in tongues out of fear. No! Rabba konshela babaria la manja la bashi. Hey, gabasoko baria. Hallelujah! They say, they kidnapped that person. A brother? A sister? Let them be driving while you're in the car. They are in trouble. Just don't say please. Never beg. While they are driving, and you notice they are taking you to somewhere you don't, just urakashendele boboria. They say, shut up. Ora baba yela ma baba sondo. Don't beg. As you're speaking, umrogo shige mama. Hey, abo soko tidi babaka telemabaya. Iraka baba baba ondoro baba. You know, this guy is sitting over here, the other one is sitting over here. Begin to touch them. Contact. Ora shiba mama kuba. Hey, 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 hey. Glory. Hallelujah. Touch them. If you touch them the first time, nothing happens. Increase the power. Increase the power. You know what? They will say, please come down. Otherwise, my God will kill them right on the spot. We have to use what we've got. We have something supernatural. Can you say amen? He says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, let's be through with this. He says God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. Hey. How long will you judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? See, he came among the gods. Who are these gods? His own people. He says, don't judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked. Don't be afraid of them. He says, don't be afraid of them. For how long are you going to act that way? He says, now, boldly defend the poor and fatherless. Defend them. Don't be afraid. Do justice to the afflicted and needy. He says, don't run away. You are the mighty. You are the gods. He says, be bold and defend them. Defend the fatherless and the needy. Watch this. They know not. Hey, verse 4. I shouldn't skip verse 4. It's too powerful. Look at verse 4. He says, deliver the poor and needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked. He tells us. He says, deliver the poor and the needy. Rid them out. Pluck them out of the hand of the wicked. He says, you are the ones that can do it. Who does he call you? He says, the mighty. And then he calls you the gods. Look at it. It's here. Then he says, they know not. Neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. As a result, all the foundations of the earth are out of course. It says everything is upside down. You know, there's a guy one day, I heard him tell one of my sisters that he don't believe in God and he don't believe in Jesus Christ, and some years ago. So when I heard him, I came right into the room. I said, what did you say? He said he doesn't believe in God, doesn't believe in Jesus. I said, why? He said, have you seen the poor and the needy under the bridge? Suffering.
If there is a God, he can't do that. I pulled the chair closer. I said, you are right. He was startled. I said, you are right. It's not God's fault. Those who can bring them out don't know it yet. And then I preached the gospel to him there. He had something to think about. Later on, he wrote me a letter. He said, I believe what you said. And then committed himself to Jesus Christ fully and told me how he was working on a book some years later. Christian book. He had found something about God. He had discovered. Are you still in this place? He tells us to rid them out of the hand of the wicked. But we haven't done it yet. Instead, we're saying, I'm going through so many problems at my job. I need prayer. I need prayer for my finances. I need prayer for... God calls you the mighty. He calls you the gods. He says, but they know not. They don't understand. So they walk on in darkness. These mighty, these gods are walking on in darkness. Therefore, the foundations of the earth are out of course. Says everything is upside down. Things are turning out badly for people. Why? Because those who can change the situation don't know. They don't know who they are. So they walk in darkness. The darkness of crying for help from Jehovah. El Shaddai, supply my needs. Did you notice that Paul didn't say, my God shall supply all our needs? He didn't say that. He said, but my God shall supply all your needs. Read it. For himself, he says, I have learned in every circumstance or all state where I am to be independent of the circumstances. He had gone above that. He was no longer, my God shall supply my needs. He was in the realm of, I have my needs met. He was looking at the babies. He says, but my God shall supply all your needs. As for me, I have learned in whatsoever state I am, daring to be independent of circumstances. Then he says, I can do all things. He didn't say we can. He doesn't know about the others. He says, I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me. I can. I can. I can. I can. I can. I can do all things. So that's the reason when I sing that song, greater is he that is in me. I'm thinking about the whole world. The one inside me is greater than the whole world. He's bigger than the airplanes. He's bigger than every government. He's bigger than all the television stations. He's bigger than the economy. He's bigger than the dollar. He's bigger than the pound. He's bigger than everybody. Hallelujah. Bigger than all. And where is his address? Me. Let's finish this. He says, they know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said, oh, shakalamande gebroshte. Did you hear that? He's not making it new. He's reminding them. He says, I have said. I have said. I've told you. See it there. I have said, ye are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. But look, ye shall die like men. Why? Because they know not, neither will they understand. Therefore, they shall die like men. That's the reason they die like men. Did you notice when, when Abner, the captain of the host of Saul, when he died. You know what David did? David wept. David wept. He said, died Abner as a fool. Died? Your hands are not tied. Abner, you died like a fool? He wept bitterly. Because he knew it was wrong. For a mighty man like that to die like a fool. Read it. Read his lamentation. When Saul and Jonathan, his son, died, David wept. He wept. He said, Saul and Jonathan. He said, they were so strong in their lives. He said, how could Saul have died as though he was not anointed with oil? That's a man who had respect for the anointing. He said, "How?" He said, "Saul died as though he was not anointed. How could you die like that?" He knew it was wrong to die like an ordinary person. He knew it was wrong. When the anointing is on your life, it's not in the hands of men. He says, "Died Abner as a fool dieth." Abner died like a fool. Let me tell you how Abner died. Somebody killed him. Somebody stabbed him to death. And he was unarmed. And as far as David was concerned, he died like a fool. He said, "Your hands were not tied. How could you die like that? That's the wrong way to die." Saul died like a man that was not anointed. He said, "It's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong." When we sit down, I say, "This lady, every year she has miscarriage. Every time she wants to have children, there's miscarriage." Instead of going, "We really have to pray." That's our mentality. "Oh yeah, we really have to pray. Oh, yeah, 4 miscarriages in this year, you know. We have to pray." That's not the way God looks at it, though. How can you have miscarriage as though you are known that? The next time that thing's coming, say, "Hold it! You are not coming out. You are not moving." Then start speaking in other tongues. You haven't gotten to that point. You've had 4 jobs in 3 months. When you start one, I say, "Well, actually, we can't understand you. You can't continue here." You go to somewhere else, they welcome you gladly. After 2 days, somebody's angry with you. Go. It's a bad time. You see, don't. On Sunday in church. "Oh Lord, I'm just praising you right now, but if you can see my heart, you know what I'm going through." Thank God you are going through. At least you're not sinking right there, but you are going through. Hallelujah. So just go through. You just get it. Hallelujah. Just go through. He says, when you go through the fire, you shall not be burned. You walk in the water, it shall not overflow you. Go through. In fact, in Isaiah, he said, "Go through, go through." Glory to God. He said, "Go through, go through. Set up a standard for the people." That's what he said. He said, "Go through, go through." Twice. He said, "Set up a standard for the people." He says, "Count it all joy when you go through diverse tests." Don't go, "I lost the job again." No! Count it all joy when you go through diverse tests. If you have that kind of a spirit, the next job you get, they would want to keep you. It's time to close, oh. Oh! Talk in tongues a little bit. Worship him a little bit. Come on. Worship him. Praise him. Ha, ha, ha. Hallelujah. Rejoice in his presence. Go ahead and pray. Kamandogoro Sheki Bahata. Glory to his name forever. Lego Baka Sandalamandi. Kiba kasandele mo mongroshti kabade kabade legoski bronze go shalamanda laborondegi somonda glira hashatala lei groboski jor saramande mongro saprade. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ai magasiki 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 mongro diba Raka tojo de lo mondre.
Leva bata le giremondo, sojo, sojo, clear in the baka. Ibaramande le giboso cote, monte giboro de chile marie. Ha 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 ha. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, embolden yourself in the Lord. Embolden yourself in the Lord. Charge your spirit up. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue.
To order for this message and other titles by Pastor Chris, log on to www.christembassyonlinestore.org.